I have the privilege of introducing our speaker today, Pastor Byron Corbett. Pastor Byron was here for a good while, several years ago, and it's such a time that many members here remember it as a fond and great time in the church, and we are just so glad that Pastor could come and be with us this Sabbath, and he currently resides in Texas. I can tell from talking with him, he's still learning how to talk properly down there. But the Lord's working with him and being patient nonetheless. And we are so glad to have Pastor Byron, and he's going to tell you some stuff and about where he's been and what he's been doing. But he's had the opportunity since pastoring here to travel the world and win souls for Jesus and evangelism and pastor churches in various parts of the United States. And Pastor Byron, come on up and share with us today. And we're just so thankful to have you here.
Woohoo!
And, yeah.
All right.
They're yours again. Enjoy.
This guy said over there when we were praying before we came out here, said I could preach till I got tired. Let me ask those of you that were here when I was here, do I ever get tired?
No!
We're going to be here till Jesus comes, Brother Hiram. Oh, it's so great to be back here with you guys. I cannot believe this. Woo! You know, I walk in the door and somebody, do you realize that it's been 16 years this month?
Wow.
Unbelievable. And you know, things happen in 16 years. And I walk in the door and one of the dear, precious friends that knew me 16 years ago said, Byron, you've lost a bunch up here, and you've put on a bunch down here, and now, I know that's true, but do you have to tell me? But the times my wife and I, you know, spend here, wow, some of the best memories of all of our ministry, and this is just incredible to be back. I can tell you this, it's a good thing my family didn't come because they really wanted to, but it's a good thing they didn't come, because if they had, we'd be staying here. No way we'd be going anywhere. But they're there, so I guess there's a hook that'll take me back away. But by the way, I don't know what you were talking about learning how to speak Texas. Because being from the Pacific Northwest, I already know how to speak the language of heaven, so I don't need to learn another language, all right? Are we going to get along okay, Hiram? Can't get Mississippi out of that guy, but anyway. That's right. Oh, it's so good to be back with you. I hope you don't want to end at 12. You're going to have to indulge me. I got to take you down memory lane a little bit before I even begin preaching. So I hope we got this computer over on me. And do you remember this event? Yeah, that was Constance and I. We got married July 24th of 2000. I can always remember how long I've been married. The math is easy. So I did it that year. And then we had that right here in this church. And we had this place packed out. There were, what, over 500 people here, chairs out there in the foyer. It was crazy. We went out right here on the lawn, did the reception out there, and Just some of the greatest times we spent with you guys. And then, of course, the Lord took us into full-time evangelism and amazing facts. And so we began traveling. But, of course, we didn't neglect starting a family. And so when we were in Boston, we had our first baby. And that's Ainsley. Ainsley is our oldest daughter. She was born in October of 2002, and she's now 13 years old. I never thought I would see that day. It is so crazy. And that's when I still had some hair there. Now, this is our second daughter, Carly. And I know you're thinking, yeah, they all look the same. This is our third daughter, Verity. And so I'm going to show you a picture of all of them now. We just took this picture last week. So here we got Ainsley, here we got Cardi, and here we got Verity. And I'm pretty proud of them. They're great kids. And then here's all of my girls, daddy's four girls. By the way, I had to have another, you know, male companion, so I got a male dog. But then we had him neutered, so I don't know where that leaves me, you know. So there they are, and one more picture of our family. This is when we were in Tennessee about a year and a half ago. Took that picture all together one Sabbath afternoon at some friend's place. So I'll tell you more about what's been going on this afternoon. We get together and hang out a little bit. But wanted to show you the family and just to say that this is still home for us. And we're praying that someday God sees fit to bring us back to the great Pacific Northwest. All right, well, let's share together a little bit here the Word of God. I've entitled my message for today, Arise and Shine. Amen. We live in a meaningless society, as a meaningless species, in a meaningless universe. There is therefore no God and no real purpose to our lives. Do I have your attention? You're saying, Pastor, did you stray from the way while you've been gone? So says Alex Rosenberg, an atheistic professor at the University of North Carolina, Duke in North Carolina there. Most of his thinking goes this way. Let me share with you a little bit more of it. He says, nothing will ever matter. Nothing that you do will ever matter. We are just 7 billion tiny flecks of talking meat on an unremarkable planet called a mud ball, hurtling through an unimaginably vast universe for no particular reason. We are all the same hodgepodge of primordial goo. There is no purpose to anything. Wow. What a great philosophy to live life by, huh? Makes me just want to jump out of a bed every morning and greet the day. How about you? You know? Then there is the idea that you make up your own purpose. In this viewpoint, you make your own truth. You invent your own truth. These are the what's right for you may not be right for me sort of people. And this kind of thinking says things like, you can do whatever you want to do as long as it doesn't hurt somebody else. Or this kind of thinking says, winning isn't everything, it's the only thing. Or he who dies with the most toys, she who dies with the most toys, wins. But you know, have you ever seen a hearse towing a U-Haul trailer for all the toys, huh? Have you ever? Let me think about that. This kind of thinking also says we can all find God in our inner self. Well, that thinking certainly has solved the world's problems, hasn't it, folks? I think that kind of thinking is really what's led us to the moral crisis we face in our nation today. So, first of all, you can believe there is no purpose. That's just flat out depressing. Second of all, you can believe that you make your own purpose. That's selfish. Or there's a third option. You can believe that you are part of a greater purpose. A bigger story. I like to put it this way. We are designed for the best by the best. Designed for the best by the best. In other words, a loving, wise Creator God designed us to fulfill a lofty, noble, high purpose, the highest possible purpose. In fact, I like the way Rich Stearns puts it in his book, Unfinished Business. He says, if God is the author of the big story, and you are a character in that story, then it follows that the author created you, every one of you, to play a key role in his story. You see, we are not here by accident at this time in this place. South Tacoma Adventist Fellowship is here for a reason. And by the way, I like the sound of that, staff. It kind of sounds like an infection. But that's what you're here to do, right? Infect this city with the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ and get ready for people to come. Hallelujah. Huh? It's good. It's good. South Tacoma Adventist Fellowship. It's all right. I don't know how you guys accomplished that. When I came, I wanted to turn south side from two words into one word, and they wouldn't let me do it. So this is great. This is progress. All right. I got distracted for a minute there. So God has an awesome purpose for us together here at this time in this place. I want to pray with you before we go any further. Oh God, come among us as you've promised through your Spirit. Make this time meaningful for your kingdom. Make it of eternal value, not just in our lives, but for the story that you are writing. And for the coming of Jesus Christ that is even at the doors. So take this time, take this speaker, and take this group of your people, and do your thing among us, I pray, in Christ's awesome name. Amen. Let's open our Bibles together to Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 and 27. So we're talking about the fact that God has created us for a purpose. What is that purpose? I believe that this, what I'm going to say next, I believe it with all my heart, that God's noble purpose for us is twofold. There's two parts to that purpose. And the second part of his purpose grows out of the first part of the purpose. And if you don't get the first part of the purpose, you can't even get to the second part of the purpose. But if you don't get to the second part of the purpose, Satan wins. And so it's all critical that we get this together and see it from God's word, because I don't want Satan to win. How about you? He's been carrying the day for far too long on this planet. Amen? But we serve a bigger God. And God is wrapping this thing up. And he's been seeing us through. And even when it feels like our heads are barely staying above the water, God is still there. And he's still carrying us. And he's still at work to accomplish his great purpose. So what is God's first purpose for us? Genesis 1 verse 26 helps us with that. Then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. We are not accidents. We are not tiny flecks of talking meat on a mud ball. Hallelujah. This is truth. And this truth is superior to anything that any man can ever dream up. Isn't that right? The Bible teaches us that the formation of life, you and me, was a direct act and in the direct intention of a loving creator. In Genesis, everything is purposeful. Nothing happens by chance. You are not an accident. You are a purposeful part of this plan put together by an incredibly amazing, awesome God. Now, there's even more to this, though. Look at chapter 2, verse 7. Genesis 2, verse 7. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. Bible says God formed man of the dust of the ground. He made contact with his inanimate form. He touched us, you see. And then he lovingly leaned over us and he bent close. And the Bible says he breathed into us the breath of life. And we became alive. He gave us the kiss of life. That's something different here. Different in man's creation than all of the rest of creation. God is such a big, awesome God. All God has to do is say something and it happens. And he said, let there be light. I do believe in the Big Bang. God said it and bang, there it was. Right? You know, God said, let there be land. Let there be birds and whatever it was. And he spoke and all of this stuff came into existence. But with man, he did something different. And I think it tells us something very important about God's purpose for us. All the birds and bugs and bees and fish and plants and trees and flowers, God spoke them into existence, but he didn't do that with man and woman. With us, he formed us, the Bible says, and he breathed into us. In this great truth that God designed us for a noble purpose, this great truth that he put South Tacoma Adventist Fellowship here in this place at this time for a reason, let's grasp that God's first purpose is for us to know him. That's his first purpose, for us to know him. That's why God made us. He wanted to be in a relationship of love with beings that could respond to that and could reciprocate that. He wanted to be in a relationship with no masks. He wanted to be in a relationship that's deep and safe and trustworthy and encouraging and committed. He wanted to be in a relationship where you could just be yourself with all your strengths and all your weaknesses, with all your flaws and all your talents, and it's okay. Because you know you're not going to be rejected, you know you're not going to be judged, you know you're going to be loved for who you are and encouraged in your growth. That's what God offers us with himself, a relationship with no masks. You know, a relationship where, you know, you can come to church all done up, or you can be like you are when you get up in the morning and haven't spent an hour or two in front of the mirror, right? No masks. Just real. That's what God is offering us with himself, and since he made us, that's our most important relationship. Isn't that true? It's our most important relationship, and so I have a question. How are you doing with that relationship? How are you doing with the most important relationship of all? The one with your Creator. Are you giving it the daily time it needs and deserves? That was a big deal, I remember. And I hope it's a big deal still here. But I remember when I was here 16 years ago, it was a big deal for us. I was just talking with Cindy and Uli. I got to stay at their place last night, and we were talking about how we'd open up the church early in the morning for folk to come and pray on their way to work or school or whatever they were doing, and how we'd just be here in the church just praying our hearts out, and the things God did and the fellowship that grew and the relationships and the growth, the spiritual life and energy. I remember our resurrection service down there at the beach at Lakewood. You know, I remember us getting together and having baptisms down there in the Sound and up at Sunset Lake. And I remember all the things we did to grow that spiritual relationship with God, the connection with him. How are we doing with that relationship? Do you know God, or do you just know about God? You say, well, Byron, you can never know God. He's infinite. That's impossible. Yeah, I give you that. So let me say this then. Are you getting to know him better and better every day? Are you getting to love him more and more each day? Is that relationship so rich and satisfying that it excites you and makes you want to talk about it all the time? That's the question for us. having that kind of relationship with God, just like it does with any person, and you know this, I'm not telling you anything you don't know, it requires time. It takes time. But life is so hectic nowadays, isn't it? So crazy. And you wake up and your smartphone is right there, and you can already be mainlining online. First, the minute you wake up, in fact, your smartphone probably wakes you up. It's got an alarm, you know? And so whatever's happening, are we making the time for God that we need to? How are we really doing with that time for God? I thought I was doing really great until about 2 years ago. I started tracking in my Bible. My part of my devotional plan is to read one chapter in Psalms every day, one chapter in Proverbs every day, and then three chapters in the Bible. And doing that, I get through Psalms about every 5 months, I get through Proverbs every month, and I read my Bible through in a year, okay? So I started tracking in my Bible, and I would write down the date by the chapter when I read it. And when I started doing that, all of a sudden I had to get honest. And I found out how much Byron Corbett, as a pastor, would get too busy and miss a day here and then miss a day there and ooh, and then maybe but 2 days or whatever. And it really caught me off guard. I was like, God, thank you so much that you just showed me this in my life. And since I've started doing that, it's helped me be so much more faithful and consistent with that relationship with God. And here's the deal, you know, if this congregation reflects what the studies are showing us about the average congregation, studies show that less than 20% of us are spending even 5 minutes a day in personal devotions to know Jesus Christ. Less than 20% of us are spending 5 minutes a day to know Jesus. We think we're going to come and get our fix at church, right? If you only ate one spiritual meal a week, I mean one physical meal a week, would you be surviving too well? Absolutely not. And we can't do it spiritually on one meal a week either. It's hard to be excited about someone you don't know very well. That's why, you know, some of you that were here 16 years ago and that know me, you're excited. I'm excited to see you. But there's a whole lot of you here that I don't know that I've never seen before because you're new in the last 16 years and you're like, who's this guy, you know? You're not excited about me like Corky or, you know, Sheila or somebody or Arnold or Elsa, you know? And yeah, Laura, Linda, okay, had to get it right. 16 years, can make a mistake now and then. Yeah. So if we're ever going to arise and shine for God like He called us to, we've got to know Jesus. This whole thing starts with knowing Jesus. And just because I go to church once a week, and just because I give tithes and maybe even offerings, and just because I'm a part of the ministry team or the leadership team or the elder ministry or I have a church office or I play the piano or whatever I do, and even being in church is part of my culture, just because all that's there, it doesn't mean I know Jesus. Doesn't mean it. Now, those things are all good, and they sure support that, and they sure encourage that, and they can help us stay strong in it. So don't get me wrong. Don't go out and say, well, Pastor Byron said I could know Jesus without being part of a church. Doesn't work, folks. I've seen too many over the last, can't believe I'm going to say this, 24 years of ministry. I've seen enough people that said, yeah, I can do Jesus without the church. No, you can't. No, you can't. It just does not work. God gave us each other for a reason. We're on a mission together. So there is absolutely nothing so rich and so fulfilling and inspiring and empowering as knowing God. But the devil works really hard to stop that from happening in our lives. And you know that's true. And so I just want to encourage you. Whatever you have to do to have time with Jesus, do it. Let nothing stop you. Because I want to have a celebration with you around the throne of God on the sea of glass that's never going to end. And we got to know Jesus. We got to know Jesus. But let's go in our Bibles to Matthew chapter 28. We're going to talk a little bit here about the second part of God's purpose for us. First, it's to know God. You've got that part. Have you figured out the second part yet? Oh, you probably have, because you've probably heard this saying before. First part is to know God. The second part, his second purpose is to make him known. To know him and to make him known. You see, God's second purpose for us is to make him known. And when we know Jesus, as it is our privilege to know him, then we cannot help making him known. That will just flow out of us. It will come naturally, and it's going to be exciting, and it's going to be joyful, and it's going to be awesome. Here's how Jesus put it, Matthew 28, 19 and 20. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. I am with you always, he said, even to the end of the age. Go, Jesus said, do what?
Go.
Go, that's right. Now, you know, in order to become a pastor, they make you study Greek. And so I wanted to make sure that I could understand that two-letter word. Go. So I went and I got my Moulton's Analytical Concordance, and I got my Art and Gingrich Lexicon, and I did all that, and I looked up this word go in the Greek every which way you could, and I looked at every little lexicon and commentary about it, and you know what I learned it meant after all that? Go. It still meant go! And he said, go and make disciples. He didn't say, sit in our churches behind our walls and enjoy our nice worship services for ourselves. Not. That's not what he said. He said, make disciples, baptize them, teach them, grow them. And by the way, he said, while you are doing that, I am with you always. Woo. You know, as I was praying and meditating and looking at this passage, it's funny how God gives you something you never saw before in a passage that you feel like is as old as the hills, you know? And here I am looking at this, and all of a sudden God showed me something that I'd never seen before. Maybe you've already seen this and you got it all figured out. But Jesus' promise to never leave us or forsake us and to always be with us was given in the context of going, making disciples, baptizing, and teaching them. It was given in the context that we are focused on what? Mission. And so if we're not doing mission, is Jesus' promise to always be with us still true? If we are not doing mission, is Jesus always with us? Maybe not so much. Maybe that's why so much of what happens in churches has nothing to do with Jesus sometimes. Just a thought. Just a thought. His promise to always be with us was given in the context of being about the mission. God, now, I know that Jesus is with us all the time, but understand, this promise in Matthew has to do with going and baptizing and teaching, right? Making disciples. God's purpose for us is to make him known and to make it very intentional and single-minded and be that about that. Now, I had the joy, as you know, I'm here because of it, of pastoring here very early in my ministry, started in Lacey, just completely wet behind the ears, you know, and then after 3 years, they moved me up here, and you don't have to say it, I admit it, I was really green. You know, I didn't really have a clue much about what was going on, and I know you were probably going, why do we have to be train the baby pastor church, right? Here we go again, train the baby pastor church. But you didn't complain about it, and you didn't, you know, say anything to me about it. And here I had all these crazy things that I wanted to do and try, and you loved on me, and you supported me, and we were just crazy together. I mean, it was crazy. Talk about crazy. You know, we were still trying to finish up the parking lot and this building project around here, and we have bought this backhoe, and we're getting stuff done finally, because we'd been in the church too many years and we still didn't have a certificate of occupancy. The city of Tacoma was kind of looking the other way, giving us a lot of grace. And anyway, we're trying to get things wrapped up and done, and there used to be this big old rock out here in the middle of this lawn, okay? And everybody's talking about, we need to move that rock, and that rock's just in the wrong spot, and it's in the way, and we need to move that thing. And so we're all been talking about this all the years that I was here. And finally, one day, we're out here having a work bee, and I figure, you know what, I'm the kind of guy, enough talk, let's just get it done already, okay? So, you know, I grew up running all kind of equipment, working in ready-mix concrete with my dad, so I hop on the backhoe, I go over here, and I get ready to move the rock. And I get that old hoe out there, and I get that bucket under that rock, and I'm going to pick it up and move it. But you know what? I'm young, and you know what? I didn't think to have the city of Tacoma do a locate for us before digging under the rock. Corky's laughing at me. He knows what's coming. Next thing I know, man, we hear this. But you don't see anything. I got into the natural gas line down there. It's spraying all over the place. We had to call up the fire department and the city and get that thing turned off and whatever. So it was crazy. I admit, it was a little crazy around here sometimes. But we had fun. We had so much fun. Anyway, let's get back to this idea here, this message. So I didn't know a lot when I got here and when I started ministry, but I did know one thing. And that one thing I knew was this. The only reason the church exists on earth is to grow God's kingdom. That's the only reason we're here. That's it. End of story. And somehow I knew that if we'd focus on that, God would be with us. And I knew that God would bless us. And I knew He would pour out His love upon us and His power upon us, and good things would happen. And so we set about doing that, growing God's kingdom. We set about doing that together. And maybe you came along kicking and screaming. I was too young and inexperienced to know the difference. But you can't, and you might have drug your feet, but you came anyway. And we did it together, and God did work in our midst, didn't He? And you know what? There was a great energy, and there was a great spirit in this place. And you know what? I'm happy to say today, when I walked in that door, I felt the same good energy, and I felt the same good spirit. So I know God is doing stuff in this place. I know He's doing that. You see, the church, and not just the church, but South Tacoma Adventist Fellowship exists for one reason only: to grow God's kingdom on earth, to go make disciples. In her wonderful book called The Acts of the Apostles, that talks about the early church that Jesus left here on earth behind when He left so that He could get done what He started, Ellen White says this. On the very first page, when she starts right in the book, the very first paragraph on that page, the very first sentence in the very first paragraph on that very first page, she says this: the church is God's appointed agency for the salvation of men. It was organized for what? Service. And its mission is to what? Carry the gospel to the world. Absolutely. The church is here for what? Mission, service, to carry the gospel to the world, nothing else. And so I decided that no matter what else we did as a church, evangelism was going to be a top priority. 2 years into ministry, I was still down in Lacey, I decided we needed to do an evangelistic series. Now, I was pretty scared, because I'd never done one of those things before, you see. And neither had the church really ever done anything quite like that before. And so I had a lot of questions. What if the church doesn't want to help out?
And what if the advertising fails? And what if nobody comes to the meetings? And then, well, what if they come and then they all quit coming? And what if nobody makes decisions? And what if nobody wants to be baptized and give their life to Jesus and become part of the church? And I've never preached sermons like this before. I don't even have any sermons like that. What am I going to... But you know what? We didn't let any of that fear stop us. We did it. I knew it was what God had called us to, and so we went ahead anyway and did it. And the church down there in Lacey, it rallied around me. And Ron Halverson Sr., my mentor, he loaned me his sermons. And we did our first series. And it was so crazy. It's a good thing I didn't have a wife then, because the thing, you know, the church was my wife. It was the other woman. And anyway, I was just living and breathing and eating and sleeping this thing. And it was, that first series was so crazy. I would be writing my sermons and finishing them up the very day where I'm supposed to preach them. And I would be finishing them up in my office. I'd have the elder go out, start the meeting, get the announcements out of the way, and I'd barely make it out on the platform with my message to preach. He'd get going, and then I'd show up. Preach. And then we visited. And in that very first series, we did a baby pastor at that church down there in Lacey. God gave us at the end of it 15 souls. We're baptized. And you know what? I've never looked back since. Never looked back since. That series grew me. It grew all of us down there in that church so much. And every series does that, by the way. It grows you. It grows the church. And it brought our church together. We got excited about Jesus and our mission. And at least by the time I came here, I had one series under my belt. I wasn't a complete neophyte, right? And so we started doing series here. And first one, we went down to Ford Middle School. I don't know if you remember that, right? And we set up in the cafeteria. We packed the place out down there. God did. At the end of that series, we baptized, 25, 30, somewhere between 25 and 30 souls. And the church was just loving it and growing it. And when you're working for Jesus, when you're helping share Christ with others, oh, it grows you and it strengthens you and it helps us stay away from sinful temptations, because we're busy working for God, and so idle hands are the devil's workshop, right? And so if you got idle hands, it's going to be a problem. But working for God, good things are going on, and we just started doing that. And somehow, you know, I don't know how, but I conned you into helping with that first series we did here, you know, and we did it together, and we had lots of fun, and God grew this church. And because we were faithful in little things, and because we were trying, God began bringing bigger opportunities along, didn't he? Remember, we got to host Hope Beyond 2000, Net 97, right? Remember this crazy sanctuary? We got aluminum girders hanging from the beams in here with lights and everything, punched a hole out the back wall to get the projector in this thing to put on the screen, and we got the series, the meetings from here going all over the world by satellite. Amen. Praise God, and we planted a church out of that over in Lakewood, Voice of Hope. Amen. You know, and God was blessing us, and then I remember, you know, a few years later, they're starting, praise God. They figured at the university over there in Walla Walla, the pastoral graduates there, they ought to learn how to do some evangelism. What a thought. Hey, let's start teaching our pastors how to win some souls. Praise the Lord, they finally figured that out. Stick your nose in a book and argue about where the dot on the I should be, you know. This is what a lot of theology is nowadays. Let's split hairs, you know, and argue about the stuff that nobody, it's not going to make a hill of beans if somebody gets saved or not. That's not going to make them get saved or lost. And we spend all our, okay, I'm going to stop. Okay. So get back to the story. So they decide they're going to do this thing, and they want a big fancy church in some big city, you know. And they tried to do one, I'm not going to say where or what church, but they tried to get going down there somewhere south of us. In that other state just south of us down there. I won't say too much more. But, you know, that church down there, oh, no, we don't do evangelism. It's in the summertime. Nobody's around in the Pacific Northwest in the summertime. Can't hold meetings in the summertime. So they're getting desperate because it's time to get going. They have no place, so they come up here to us. and they say, would your church consider hosting the Field School of Public Evangelism for Walla Walla University? And so what did we do? We were crazy enough. We said, sure, right? Come on, we'll do it. It's in the middle of summer. Jack Cologne comes in. We get all busy. Some students from Walla Walla come. We do this thing together. Do you folk remember how many people got baptized out of that series? In the middle of the summer, July and August, mind you. We started down over here. What was that hotel? It was the Best Western, right over. Is it still there? So much. I came driving through here, and I'm like, oh, this has changed a lot. You know, what happened? The Bass Pro Shop right over here now. Was that the Mega Foods used to be there or something? I was like, where are the landmarks here now? You know, different landmarks. They're here, but they're different. And so anyway, you know, we started over there in the Best Western, and then we moved over here to the church. And at the end of those meetings, in the middle of summer, Pacific Northwest, God gave us like 55 or 60 souls. It was awesome. And God is the same God in 2016 that He was in 2000 or 1996. He's the same God now as He was then. And in fact, He's even more urgent about doing the same thing because Jesus is getting a lot closer to being here, if you haven't figured that out yet, folks. I don't know about you, but I'm looking at this baby winding up here. I think the gates of heaven are already open. And I think the first angels have already left. Yeah. Jesus is coming, and we need to be about our Father's business. Arise and
shine.
Hide your light under a bushel. No, right? I'm going to let it. Are we going to sing that tonight, Corky? Are we going to jam tonight? Hallelujah. All right, let's do it. Let's do it. I probably won't be able to sing by then. My fingers will probably fall off, but as long as Corky's here, we're going to play the guitar, and we're going to have a great time together. It's just awesome. Okay, where was I? Oh, you're not used to staying until 10 after 12, are you? Don't bother looking at the clock. I'm just getting warmed up. I'm not tired. All right. Well, so we did that. We just had a grand time together. Let's go to Matthew 9. I want to look at Matthew 9 for a few minutes here. And I emphasize this morning, God's purpose, second purpose for us is to make Him known. It's to make Him known. And I emphasize this because this is such a critical issue. And churches all across the country and the continent are struggling with this. And churches are becoming a club, not a movement. Are you hearing me? Churches are becoming a let's get together and feel good with ourselves instead of we are on a mission. And here in Matthew 9, verse 36, by the way, it's hard to believe that I've been in ministry 24 years. 24 years! I was that old when I started! I had a big aha moment about 2 weeks ago where I'm pastoring now. A guy came to visit who, when I was 15 years old, was my pastor up in Hope, British Columbia. And I thought he was an old man. And I started doing the math. And I discovered that when he was pastoring me when I was 15 years old, he was the same age as I am right now. And I looked at my kids and I said, and they said, Dad, you're old. Somehow, you know, I kind of got stuck at the age I was when I was here at this church, right? Right here at South Tacoma Adventist Fellowship. I got stuck at that age. I mean, it's just the golden age. I got stuck there, and that's where I am in my head. I'm still that old, but I guess a lot of people don't see me that way anymore. And, of course, with the hairline situation, yeah, well, anyway. Okay. See, I can begin to count my hair, right? God said, yeah, He can count the hairs in your head. I used to think that was miraculous. I don't anymore, at least for me. All right, no, it's all good. Okay, so here's I have seen the truth in this next statement proven over and over again that I'm going to make right now. Seen it in my 24 years of ministry, proven over and over again. If the church loses its focus on mission, it's dead and just doesn't know it yet. It's already dead, just doesn't know it yet. And I've traveled all across North America, Canada, United States many times. I've worked for probably 60, 70, 80 different churches, and it never, ever changes. If the church loses its focus on mission, it dies. Even in Jesus' day, that was a problem for the church. Look at it right here in Matthew, verse 36, chapter 9. Jesus loved people, man. He just loved people. And so he's going out, verse 35, he's all among them, you know, preaching, healing, all these people. And then verse 36, but when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion for them because they were weary and scattered like sheep having no shepherd. People mattered to Jesus. They're the most important thing on his radar screen was people and what was going on in their lives. And he was moved with compassion for them because he knew they needed something. And sheep are kind of dumb. They don't know. They know they need something, but they don't even know what they need, and they don't even know they need what they need. Was that confusing? That's kind of how sheep are. And so Jesus knew what they needed, and he had compassion on them. And he said, in the context of that, he said, verse 37, then he said to his disciples, the harvest truly is what? Plentiful, but the laborers are what? Few. Therefore, pray or beseech. The Greek there is plead earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Why do you think that Jesus had to say the harvest was plentiful, but the laborers were few? Because the church didn't have a mission focus. Why do you think Jesus had to plead with us to pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send laborers into the harvest? Because the church had lost its mission focus. And for too many of us, church is not about the lost. Church is about us. It's about, what can the church do for me? Does the church make me feel good when I come here? Does it do things exactly the way I like things to be done? Does the church care for me? And does the church notice me? And does it do things for me? And does it serve me? And does it make me feel happy? We have a consumer mentality, not a contributor mentality. We have a self-centered interest in the church a lot of times. But that is not what the church is here on earth for. It is not here to serve me. It is here to participate with Jesus in his mission of saving lost people. When we come to church, we should not be asking, what can the church do for me? How can it help me out? When we come to church, we should be asking, what can I help the church do to reach the people who aren't here yet? The revival that God seeks among us is that we would change from a consumer mentality to a contributor mentality. The revival that God seeks for us is a mindset in which the church is going outside of its walls, and that becomes more important to going outside the walls than what is happening inside the walls for the people that are in here. The danger of any movement is to drift from mission to maintenance. That's what's happening across the church today. In the beginning, you see, structures and organizations and institutions are born to facilitate the mission. And so we create schools and we create different things and we create mission organizations and whatever so that we can carry out the mission and accomplish that. And that's what we did in the beginning. And mission was tops. And all those other things we created, those institutions, those organizations, they were there to serve the mission. But what happens is after a while, you forget about the mission and we get more worried about maintaining the organizations that we made to facilitate the mission, and the organizations and the institutions take up all the energy and we forget about the mission. And unfortunately, some of the things that we try to keep alive aren't about the mission anymore. And if the church loses its focus on mission, it's dead and just doesn't know it yet. The issue is, am I as a Christian inward focused or outward focused? Do I think the church is here to serve me, or is it here to serve the lost? You know, George Barna did a survey about this mission focus among Christians, and George Barna's research on the church is really, really revealing. It shows us a lot of things about ourselves that we don't want to know, because they're not always very complimentary about ourselves. That's why he's affectionately called Bad News Barna. Okay, and George Barna's survey revealed this, that 91% of Christians believe their church exists to serve them. What kind of focus is that? That's an inward focus, absolutely. Why does the church exist? Yeah, Jesus said what? Go make disciples. Ellen White said that the church's mission is to carry the gospel to the world. We are not here to serve ourselves. We are here to serve the lost. The reason churches are not growing today is, but that they are plateaued, in many cases are declining and dying, is because 91% of us have an inward focus. And that makes a sick church. It also makes a disobedient church. You say, a disobedient church? How disobedient? Jesus said, go, make disciples. That's the Great Commission. We call it the Great Commission. Go, make disciples. Jesus set up his church on earth as a missional entity, and if we are not carrying out that mission, if we are not going, we are being disobedient to Jesus Christ himself. Jesus also said, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Amen? He established his church to prevail against the gates of hell, not the other way around. To put it another way, Jesus was saying, I am building my church to depopulate Satan's zip code. I love that. It's an outward focus, right? An outward focus makes a healthy church. An outward focus makes a growing church. He put us here to depopulate Satan's zip code, take back the captives of Satan, and get them into the kingdom of God before Jesus comes. That's why he put us here. He didn't say, I'm going to build my church so it can gather every Sabbath for awesome worship. He didn't say, I'm going to build my church so it can listen to great preaching every week and teaching. He didn't even say, I'm going to build my church so it can be a really friendly and loving and fun place. He said, the church is to take back hostages from Satan's camp. You see, the gates of hell, that was the war analogy of Bible times. If the enemy got to the gates and conquered the gates, the city was overthrown. And that's why Jesus said, no, you know, hell is not going to prevail against the kingdom of God. We are going to overcome. We got to depopulate Satan's zip code. Do you want Jesus to come soon? I do. Absolutely. Do you want to go home to heaven? Amen. Then listen to this. The work of God on this earth can never be finished until the men and women comprising our church membership do what? Rally to the work and unite their efforts with those of ministers and church officers. You are blessed to have the Resters here, and I know they're leaving soon, but God's provided. You're blessed with who's taken over. Work together and be about the mission so Jesus can come. Here's a question. How many people in Tacoma, watch this, how many people in Tacoma are going to hell unless something changes in their life between now and when Jesus comes. How many and how much do you and I care about that? How much do we care about it? They always say you can tell what's important to you by where you spend your money and where you spend your time. Dennis Prager has a talk show in Southern California. He's a talk show host there in Southern California. And every year he conducts a survey among high school seniors. And he's been doing this survey for the last 20 plus years. And every year he asks the same question. And every year he's gotten the same response from these high school seniors. Here's his question. If both were drowning, which would you save first, your dog or a stranger? If both were drowning, which would you save first, your dog or a stranger? Do you know how the high school seniors answer them? One third of them say that they would save the dog. One third of them say they would save the stranger. And one third of them say the question is too difficult for them to answer. Now, I don't know how I would have answered that question when I was a high school senior. But I can tell you this, I know without a question how I would answer that question now. Without a second thought, I would save the stranger. I would save the stranger. And I have some advice for you, by the way. If you are planning on drowning anytime soon, wait until there are at least three high school seniors there, because two of them won't do you any good. Yes. Two of them won't do you any good. That's right. Okay. Now, Dennis Prager has a further question for the high school seniors, the two of them, the two-thirds, that didn't choose to save the stranger. He says this, why on earth wouldn't you save the person? And here's what they said. I know my dog. I don't know the stranger. I love my dog. I don't love the stranger. I care about my dog. I don't care about the stranger. Do you care about the stranger? Do you care about the people in this city that you've never met, that you have no idea who they are and what's going on in their lives? Do you care about whether they get to go to heaven with Jesus when he comes, or whether they end up burning in hell? Do you care? Do I care? Jesus said the harvest was plentiful, but the laborers were few. What are we here at South Tacoma Adventist Fellowship? What are we going to do about that? You know, I remember as a kid driving with my dad and my two brothers, four of us. As an age when I was a teenager, and it's kind of all into the materialism thing, you know, and we'd be driving along and we'd see a big fancy 4x4 truck and we're just oohing and on over, you know, or drive along, you see some amazing mansion up on a hill, you know, and you're looking, ooh, that must have cost, you know, and we're just all into this materialism, oohing and on over it, and Dad's sitting there listening to us, and as soon as he could find a little break in the car after it kind of slowed down a little bit, I remember him saying to us, boys, he said, boys, just remember this, someday it's all going to burn. It's all going to burn. And I've never forgotten that, because people are the only thing from this sinful, broken, tired, worn out, sick old earth. people are the only thing that's going to heaven. Everything else is going to burn. That career, that big house, that nice car, whatever, and have the stuff and enjoy it or whatever, but it's all going to burn. And when Jesus is standing there and we're looking at him, I don't want to say, Jesus, I spent all my energy on stuff that burnt. I want to stand there with my arms around a group of people too big to embrace, because they're going to go to heaven with me. How about you? What do you want to do? People are the only thing that's going. And how many people here in Tacoma are going to burn unless something in their life changes between now and when Jesus comes? And I want to invite you today. I want to invite you to make a commitment to arise and to shine and to be about your Father's business as never before. You're on that road now, but I want to invite you to make a recommitment to that. I'm going to ask you just to come on down and join me right down here at the front of this place. If you want to say, Jesus, you prayed that God would send laborers into the harvest, because the harvest was big, but there wasn't enough people to get it, and it's going to go bad if we don't get it. And I want to be, come on in, man, get close to me, I need that. I want to be, love you, brother, man. I want to be part of the answer to your prayer, Jesus. Your prayer to send laborers into the harvest. Your prayer to make an eternal difference in people's lives. Your prayer to change this part of the harvest here in South Tacoma. I love you guys. God's going to do big stuff with you. He's got big plans. He's not done. He's just getting started. And if you'll work together, there's no limit to what God's going to do with you. Let's just bow our heads and just pray together. Oh, Heavenly Father, we're just unworthy, God. We're just broken people, and we look at our lives and we see how we stumble and fall and fail, and we got trials and we got challenges, and sometimes we're not even sure we can hang on to you, God. But in spite of all that, we claim the promise that your strength is made perfect in our weakness. And it's your weakness, it's our weakness that gives you the opportunity to show how big and awesome and powerful you are. And so even though we can't do it, God, we want you to come in and fill us, and we want to be part of Jesus' answer to this prayer that you would send laborers into your harvest, God. Oh, I pray for this congregation, Lord. I praise you for what you're doing in its midst right now. I praise you for the precious people, ones I knew 16, 17, 18, 19 years ago, and ones that I get to start getting to know today, who've been part of this family during those 16 years since then, God. I pray for them all, and I just pray that you will mold them into an unstoppable team for you, that you'll help us to put aside some of the little petty arguments and preferences that sometimes, Lord, derail and bog down your people, and that you will give us a single-minded heart for the gospel of Jesus Christ and for lost people, and that we would come together and together do whatever it takes. Lord, as long as we're faithful to truth, as long as we're faithful to the principles of your word, we won't compromise, God. We're not going to do that, but we're going to do whatever it takes to be a light, to be an ark of safety that the struggling people of this city can come into and know Jesus, so that when he comes, they don't cry for the rocks and mountains to fall and hide them, but they look up and rejoice and say, this is our God. We've waited for him, and he's come to save us. And he looks at them and he says, well done, good and faithful servants. Come and enter into the joy of your Lord. Oh God, you're going to do that here, I know it. And together, in your name, we give you permission in our lives And we thank you for the Spirit who comes to do what we could never do. And we want to now together give you all the honor and all the glory. It's in Jesus' awesome name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Let's sing with the team. You can make your way to your seats. Let's keep worshiping. God.